Hello friends, welcome to Mains Maxima. This question is on Panchayat Raj Institution and it is one of the most important topics which will be expected every year, including this year 2018. We'll read out the question first. Can Panchayats truly be considered as self-governing institutions? Assess whether the spirit of decentralization taken a deep root in the democratic spaces of India with suitable contemporary examples. So initially in the introduction, we have to speak about the 73rd and the 74th Amendment Act. This should be the introduction. Then in the middle of the answer, we should discuss about the problems which the PRIs are facing today. And finally, we'll have to give a very fitting conclusion. This is what the structure of the answer. We'll start with the introduction. This can be the introduction. The 73rd and 74th Amendment Act has established a constitutional and legal basis for local self-governance in India. It has deepened democracy. It has resulted in inclusiveness, because inclusiveness will make a democracy deep. This is contributing for inclusion, political inclusion, and a number of people in Indian society were not able to access the levers of power because we were living in a caste-based society. So, there should be participation of the marginalized communities in the society, and this 73rd, 74th Amendment Act is providing a possibility and a certainty, of course, for a number of marginalized sections to participate, including women, scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, because there is reservation for women, SC/ST in the local self-governance. So this can be an introduction. Then what are the limitations? Because Panchayat Raj Institution was institutionalized as an agent of social change, whether they were able to produce a social change as it was contemplated, or is there any limitation? We of course have a number of limitations. We'll discuss these limitations. Despite of acting as agents of social change, they suffer from certain structural irregularities or structural limitations. Which are the structural limitations? We'll see one by one. According to a principle called as principle of subsidiarity, it says that those units which are very closest to the citizens, they should be given devolution of power. Only if the units which are closest to the citizens are unable to act, then the power will have to be realized by the layer above the closest unit of the citizen. And that is what the main principle present in the PRI. The principle of subsidiarity stipulates that functions must be carried out closest to the citizens at the smallest unit of the governance possible. It should be delegated upwards only when there is a impossibility or difficulty for the local unit to devolve the power. First limitation is that whether the principle of subsidiarity is followed or not. What is the principle of subsidiarity stipulating? It says that function should be performed by a closest unit. Function should be performed by unit which is closest to the citizen. And if the closest unit to the citizen is unable to perform the function, then the function will have to be devolved to the layer above. So this is the demand of the principle of subsidiarity, that function shall be carried out closest to the citizens at the smallest unit of governance possible and delegated upwards only when the local unit cannot perform the task. However, this is not followed, because even though constitution is mandating that there should be a Panchayat Raj institution, many of the state governments, in some cases it took years, in some cases it took decades to constitute the local self-governance and hold the election. Even when elections were held and the PRI bodies were constituted, subsequently the states are not conducting the election, as a result of which the PRI is unable to perform its task as mandated in the constitution, because the states are not willing to devolve power to the PRIs. Secondly, strengthening the voice of the local bodies. There is a constitutional provision, Article 171, which says that 1/3 of the members of legislative council shall be elected by the local bodies. Given the more number of local bodies, given the more number of people participating in the local bodies today, that this 1/3 of the members, MLC selected by the local body, this proportion will have to be improved. So we are asking that given the importance of democratic decentralization, more number of MLCs should be elected by the local body members. Thirdly, constitution of the state election commission. The tenure, the conditions and the qualifications of the state election commission is now decided by the state government. But actually, according to the National Commission to Review the Working of the Constitution, the recommendation is State Election Commission should be brought under the control of the Election Commission of India, because the State Election Commission is dependent on the state government. They have to become objective, they have to become independent, and that is possible only if we place State Election Commission under the Union Election Commission or the Election Commission of India. So such a measure that placing the State Election Commission under the Election Commission of India will give the required independence of the Election Commission, State Election Commission, from the state government, and they will be able to discharge their duty in a very objective manner. The next point is, fourth point, devolution of powers and responsibility. There is Article 243G regarding to panchayats and 243W regarding to municipalities. It says that the subjects can be transferred to the local bodies by the state government. But many of the state governments have not appropriately transferred the subjects present in the schedules, especially Schedule 11 and Schedule 12. These schedules deal with the subjects which are to be governed by the panchayats, that is Schedule 11, and subjects which has to be governed by the urban local body, Schedule 12. So many of the state governments have not actually devolved the power. Some have given only few subjects to the local bodies, whereas some have given more subjects to the local body. So there is a variation in the devolution of power depending on the states. Next point, fifth point, is the implementation space. We have seen that there is so many multiplicity of the governmental agencies on one single subject at the local body level, and that is resulting in confusion, unnecessary duplication of the work, inefficiency, wastage of fund, poor outputs, and these are the outcomes of a situation called as organizational jungle. Next point is, sixth point, devolution of funds. Local bodies are financially dependent on the central government. They are financially dependent on the state government. They do not have any financial autonomy. They don't have any financial autonomy because they are perpetually dependent on the center and the state. Many of the buy-in taxes, like that of the state excise, VAT, motor vehicle tax, they become a part of the consolidated fund of the state. So there is no financial autonomy, and the panchayats are stripped of the financial resources, which is why they are not able to perform their task of democratic decentralization. Next is the capacity building for the self-governance. And this is an area which is not adequately taken care of by the state as well as the center. The crucial issue is capacity building of both the urban bodies as well as the local bodies. But these local body people were given only a short-term training, and they were not given a long-term training. Many of the training long term, even it is not contemplated, and that is why this is a lacunae present, that there is no effective capacity building of the local bodies, and this has to be remedied. Next point is proxy governance. We know that there is a prevalence of patriarchy even today, as a result of which, though reservation is given to women, really the power is exercised by the husband of the women or the male relatives of the women. So proxy governance is one of the ailing issue of the Panchayat Raj institution. Now we have to write a conclusion. The conclusion is, there are something positives and we have to do something. So much needs to be done will have to be the line of thinking when you write the conclusion. While steps like Mahatma Gandhi Rural Employment Guarantee Act, e-Panchayats, they are positive developments, but Panchayat institutions must have to be given proper training and social empowerment, especially it should be given to women and the deprived communities. There should be more devolution of power, and for this to happen, a substantive transformation is needed. A substantive transformation of Panchayat Raj institutions into true self-governing institutions requires political statesmanship, not only from the state but also from the center, and this would become the conclusion for this answer. Now the next question is on freedom of speech. We'll discuss the answer for this question. First of all, we'll read the question. Discuss with relevant judgments of the Supreme Court the immense significance in protecting free speech against arbitrary restrictions. In the introduction, you have to do something good about free speech. Then we'll have to discuss the Supreme Court judgments. It is said judgments, so you have to write more than one judgments. And finally, we have to speak about how freedom of speech is the cardinal value in a democratic society. So this is the structure of the answer. Given the structure, we'll see the answer. This is the introduction. That rights are the cornerstone of individual autonomy. Without individual right, there is no individual autonomy. They are guaranteed as limitations on the power of the state, because state is having power, it may commit excesses, and rights are coming as a defense against the state excesses. We have seen Article 19(1)(a) is providing right to freedom of speech and expression. Supreme Court many a times have told that right to freedom of speech and expression and right to life, they are correlatives of each other. They are inalienable adjuncts of each other. If 19(1)(a) is violated, then 21 is violated. If 21 is violated, then 19(1)(a) is violated. So that is how right to freedom of speech and expression comes under right to life according to the Supreme Court of India. We'll have to discuss about one important Supreme Court judgment, and that is Shreya Sinhal case 2015. The Supreme Court has struck down Section 66A of the Information Technology Act 2000 as unconstitutional because it violates right to freedom of speech and expression. So that is what we have to start with. Because they have asked Supreme Court judgments, you have to quote definitely Supreme Court judgments, and that gives the weightage to your answer. Supreme Court declared that Section 66A of the Information Technology Act is unconstitutional because it is providing a destructive effect, which is causing a chilling effect on the freedom of speech. So it is undemocratic because it is causing a chilling effect on the freedom of speech. The Supreme Court in this case differentiated between three forms of speech. Number one, discussion. Number two, advocacy. And number three, incitement. You can discuss, you can advocate any view, the view may be unpopular, but you cannot be arrested. Only if it is amounting to incitement, then reasonable restriction can be imposed, because Article 19 Clause 2 provides grounds of reasonable restriction with respect to 19(1)(a). There are 8 grounds of reasonable restriction mentioned in Article 19 Clause 2. Only based on these grounds, reasonable restrictions can be imposed. Incitement is one such ground, which is why the court is saying it should cause incitement, only then the person can be arrested or the reasonable restriction can be imposed. All other forms of speech, even if it is offensive, it may be unpopular, they have to be protected under Article 19(1)(a). Incitement is a key to determine the constitutionality of restriction on the freedom of speech. So it is incitement which is very much needed for imposing restriction. The speech must amount to incitement in order to be restricted, and this has to become an acceptable norm to the limitations of speech. The imminent threat to lawless action test. US is having a test called as imminent threat to lawless action test, and this action test of US is also having the same provision or having the same reason called incitement to put a reasonable restriction to curb the freedom of speech. In case of US, there is a restriction on freedom of speech only if it is passing a test called as the imminent threat to lawless action test. And here also they are telling that only if the speech is causing incitement, then restriction can be imposed. So their test of freedom of speech is also resonating with that of our Supreme Court reasoning. Liberty and equality are complementary of each other. Only when there is a liberty of thought, only when there is a liberty of expression, then there can be equality. Because without equality, there is no liberty. Without liberty, there is no equality. When there is no equality and liberty, there is no democracy at all. Extremity of speech. What is called as hate speech? In order to qualify as a hate speech, the speech must be offensive and it has to project an extreme form of emotion. So only when it is triggering an extreme form of emotion, then it can be called as hate speech. Only when there is an incitement, it can be called as hate speech. Every offensive statement, however, is not amounting to hate speech. Only if it is inciting violence, then such a speech can come under the category of hate speech. Potentiality of the speech. The potential impact of the speech has to be viewed to determine the speaker's state of mind at the time speech was rendered. So we have to find out what was the state of mind of the speaker at the time of he speaking. In case of Ramesh versus Union of India case, the Supreme Court examined the validity of restriction on the basis of the potential impact of the movie on the audience. Only if it is causing a huge impact on the audience negatively, then restriction can be acceptable. It can be reasonable. Censorship is valid only if it is causing a very big impact on the audience. In Life Insurance Corporation of India versus Professor Manubhai D. Shah case, Supreme Court held that restriction has to be interpreted very strictly and narrowly. So you cannot have a liberal interpretation of restriction. It has to be restricted. It has to be interpreted in a very narrow sense, because restrictions will have to be viewed always with a suspicion, thereby throwing a heavy burden on the authorities who seek to impose them. So restriction should not be liberally interpreted, it should be narrowly interpreted. Any type of restriction imposed by the state should be doubted, it should be suspected. Every seemingly hateful act or hateful speech may not be called as hate speech. It may be seemingly hateful, but it may not be called as hate speech. So the context in which the speech was made is more important. The intent is important, the content is important, and the motivation is more important, and the impact is important. Only then you can qualify such speech as hate speech. The intent of freedom of speech is not to disregard the weaker sections of the society, rather it is to give equal voice to the weaker sections of the society. Liberty of thought and expression is not just an aspirational ideal, rather it is a cardinal value that is of paramount significance under our constitutional scheme. So it is not just an ideal, it is the cardinal value of our constitutional scheme itself. A number of cases, the highest courts of India, Apex Court and the High Courts, have consistently upheld and championed the fundamental right of free speech and expression enshrined in the Constitution. This includes the right to put forward different and contradictory views. Even though those views may be right views or wrong views, it has to be defended. John Stuart Mill, an important philosopher, in 1859, in his book On Liberty, says that the peculiar evil of silencing the expression of an opinion is that it is robbing the human race itself. So silencing the speech or violating the free speech is robbing the human race, according to John Stuart Mill. So it is better that if you end the answer, if you conclude your answer quoting some philosophers. Next question is on the Supreme Court judgment on SCST Act, March 20, 2018, which resulted in massive protests, killing 9 people during the protests. So the question is, critically examine the recent Supreme Court's judgment on the Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe Prevention of Atrocities Act 1989. In the introduction, we have to speak about the judgment. What is the judgment? Then we have to speak about why the Supreme Court defended the judgment. And then we have to speak about why the judgment of the Supreme Court was criticized. And finally, what has to be done? If not, what will happen? So this is what is the line of thinking, and this will form the structure of your answer, right? We'll start with the introduction. Definitely, we have to quote the case, name of the case, because that will give precision to your answer. The name of the case will have to be started with. The Supreme Court, in its recent judgment in Subhash Kashinath Mahajan case, has stirred up a debate which is bound to impact the law and policy on prohibition of the practice of untouchability and prevention of atrocity against SC/ST. This should be the introduction. Next is why, or next is what the Supreme Court has said. The verdict has mandated a preliminary inquiry into the complaint before a FIR can be registered and barred any immediate arrest of the accused. So there should be a preliminary inquiry. Thereafter only FIR should be filed. The court also clarified that it has not asked for non-registration of FIR for the offences. It only sought to verify whether the complaint is genuine or not. It says, the court says, approval of higher authority is needed to prosecute one who is accused under the Act. The courts can also give anticipatory bail in cases involving false complaints. The court is conscious of the fact that they have to protect the rights of the underprivileged, and this has to be placed in the highest pedestal. But at the same time, innocent persons cannot be falsely implicated. They cannot be arrested when there are false complaints made. So the judgment wanted to seek a fine balance between the rights of the Dalits and the rights of the innocent people who are arrested in the false case under this Act. Supreme Court gave the judgment on the pretext that innocence cannot be terrorized by the provisions of the Act and their fundamental right should be protected. The court is concerned about the fact that Article 21 included freedom from arbitrary arrest. So this Article 21 will have to be protected. It shall not be violated. Why this judgment of the Supreme Court was criticized, which resulted in massive protest in many parts of the India? The National Crime Record Bureau data says that a crime is committed against a Dalit every 15 minutes. Every 15 minutes, there is a crime committed against Dalit. The conviction rate under the SC/ST Act is very, very low. Only 25%. 75% cases, either they are acquitted or they are forced to withdraw their complaints. The assaults are highly increasing as far as the SC women are concerned. So more number of assaults against SC women. And National Crime Record Bureau data also says that even though the murder rate is falling in the last 5 years, murders of SCs have started increasing. Even though the conviction rate in the general crimes are increasing under the IPC sections, according to the NCRB data, that even though the conviction rate in crimes against non-SCST is increasing, the conviction rate against SCST is declining. So this is a worrying trend. The 1989 law is not allowing anticipatory bail to be given. It is prohibiting anticipatory bail, saying that the accused, when he comes on bail, he will use his liberty to terrorize the victims, because if the offender is a person belonging to a higher caste or higher class, he may try to terrorize the victim, and that is why there is no anticipatory bail. The Supreme Court has told that anticipatory bail can be given to those who are charged under this Prevention of Atrocity Act 1989. But the center argued in the court that denial of anticipatory bail is the backbone of the 1989 Act. The SCSTs have been suppressed for years, and the center says the judgment of the Supreme Court will affect the morale and the confidence of the SCSTs, and the matter will have to be decided by a larger bench. The Supreme Court will have to put this case to a larger bench according to the center. The dilution may lead to increased control of the state machinery by the upper caste and less registration of the cases against the upper caste. It may also trigger increased caste conflicts. It may lead to violence, and this may affect the social order. The NCRB data also says that there is a fall in the number of false cases. That 1 in 10 cases are false cases. So it is not that so huge number that the Supreme Court will have to come to defend those people who may be falsely implicated under the act. Less than 15% of India's Supreme Court and High Court judges are women as of date. According to the latest available figures, less than 5% of them are Dalits. And there is an unstated glass ceiling in the judiciary. The representation of women in the highest judiciary is also very less. The Indian Constitution is a charter for radical social reforms, aiming to bring about equality in a deeply divided society, which is also very hierarchical because of the caste-based stratification present in India. For it to be captured by the most privileged sections of the society, it will lead to a fundamental betrayal of the constitution itself. So, we cannot allow the society to be captured only by the privileged sections of the society, like the upper caste or the upper class. They cannot simply capture the entire legal system. They cannot capture entire decision-making powers. If it is done so, then definitely it will lead to the betrayal of the constitution itself. So, this will be the concluding statement for this question.